Hey guys, in this lesson, I'm going to cover Amazon Elastic Load Balancing. So load balancers provide high availability and fault tolerance. Essentially, they're a single endpoint, so a single DNS name or IP address behind which a bunch of different instances sit. So it's going to automatically distribute connections to those EC2 instances. Now it's not just EC2, by the way. So targets include EC2 instances, also ECS containers. You've got IP addresses as a target as well, and Lambda functions, and also other load balancers, so you can actually chain them together. There's some use cases where that's advantageous. So let's have a look at it in action. So here we have a few EC2 instances deployed in an ASG, an auto-scaling group, across multiple subnets in different availability zones. So when users come in, the load balancer is automatically distributing connections. If an instance fails, then it's going to be taken out of action. Now, Elastic Load Balancing will perform health checks. So the target group, that's the collection of the targets that you define some characteristics for and some configuration settings. The target group is going to perform health checks. So it's going to check those instances. For example, if they are web servers, it might connect on port 80, so the HTTP port, and just check a certain URL path to see if it gets a positive response, a 200 return code. Now, if it gets that success code, then it's going to assume that that instance is healthy and working and operational. If it doesn't get a successful response, then it's going to assume that instance is out of action. So after a few tries, it's going to take it out of action, and it's going to redistribute connections to a different EC2 instance. This is the point where the load balancer can also, with integration into auto-scaling, notify auto-scaling that this instance is not responding to health checks, and auto-scaling will terminate and then replace that instance. So here, user 1 is actually reconnected from instance 1 to instance 4 so that their session continues. The ELB takes the instance 1 out of service because of the failed health check, and then auto-scaling is going to terminate it. And then, of course, it can replace it. So now we have instance 5 replacing the first instance that was terminated previously. So now we have that level of availability and fault tolerance across multiple availability zones. As new users come along, of course, they get distributed. Now, by default, auto-scaling is going to try and spread the load across multiple availability zones, and the load balancer sitting in front is then going to distribute connections to all of the instances. And again, through integration between auto-scaling and load balancing, as the auto-scaling group launches those instances, it's going to notify the load balancer. So the load balancer actually knows that they're there and then can start sending connections through to them. Now we've got a few different types of load balancer. There's an old one called the classic load balancer. I'm not going to cover that because it's really been deprecated quite a long time ago, but it's still there in the console. So the important ones are the application load balancer. So this one is a layer 7 load balancer. That means it understands information in the HTTP and HTTPS headers. Okay, layer 7. So it can perform things like path-based routing or host-based routing and a few others. So path-based routing is the path in the URL. So if it's slash orders versus slash my account, it can actually send the connection to a different set of targets in a different target group. So that's path-based routing. And that's obviously a layer 7 function. It actually has to look into that URL. It's not just looking at IP addresses and port numbers. Now, these listeners are always HTTP or HTTPS. Next, we have the network load balancer. This is the connection level load balancer. So we say it runs at layer 4 because that's where these port numbers are, the TCP ports and the UDP ports, for example. Those protocols run up there at layer 4. So with this type of load balancer, it offers extremely high performance at extremely low latency. So watch out for those kind of keywords if you're taking an exam, because they often come up. So this is the one for TLS offloading as well at scale. So it's very high performance load balancer. One of the other features of the network load balancer, you can have static IPs. So those are elastic IPs in each availability zone. So that means you can hard code those and whitelist them in firewalls, for example. Lastly, we have the gateway load balancer. Very different thing here. What this is actually used for is virtual appliances, so virtual networking appliances like firewalls, intrusion detection systems, intrusion prevention systems. So we're actually able to load balance some of the incoming traffic through to those virtual appliances where they can perform some kind of inspection. So it's using the Geneve protocol instead here. So different load balancers for different use cases. Let's have a look at what those might be. So for the application load balancer, use this one when you have web applications, HTTP and HTTPS, and you need that sort of layer 7 routing capability. It's good for microservices architectures like Docker containers, Lambda targets, which are an option with the ALB. With the NLB, TCP and UDP based applications, extremely low latency, high performance, and static IP addresses, as well as VPC endpoint services as well. And then lastly, for the gateway load balancer, this is where you want to deploy, scale, and manage third-party virtual network appliances. It gives you centralized inspection and monitoring capabilities. So we're talking about firewalls, intrusion detection, intrusion prevention systems, deep packet inspection systems, and other similar virtual network appliances.